We've heard about data from some of the trials, but it's very important to consider how biologics perform in real-life data. And I'm delighted to be able to introduce Professor Itzke Fokkens from the Amsterdam Academic Medical Center to provide some of their experiences on use of biologics. Thank you.
Well, Claire, thank you very much for showing us the data of biologics, dupilumab and MAPLE in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. As we are aware, we now have the opportunity to prescribe biologics in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. And I would like to show you some of the real life data that we acquired in the last year and a half. These are my disclosures. So I want to show you the latest real-world data highlighting how effective biologics are in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. In 2019, in December 2019, as soon as we were able to prescribe biologics in the Netherlands, we started a registry of all our patients. And in that registry, we record of all patients their signs and symptoms of disease at baseline and after in the days after starting the treatment. We see them after a month and then every 3 months for as long as they have the treatment. Here, I would like to show you the data of the 131 patients that we gave dupilumab as their primary biological add-on treatment in the period up to and including May 2021, which had at least a 12-week follow-up. The primary endpoints that we record among others, but I would like to show you today are the nasal polyp score, the SNOT-22 score, and the sniffing sticks evaluation of smell, which has a score from 0 to 12, where you can see here up to 6 is anosmia, and 11 and 12 is normosmia. Here you see the data of these 131 patients. The age at the start of the therapy was 52 years old. There was a male majority of 64%. They had polyps for more than 12 and a half years on average. All but one patient had nasal surgery. One patient, he was not able to be operated. And 55 patients had more three or more times surgery, and 16 patients had five or more times surgery. The time since the most recent endoscopic sinus surgery was a little bit more than 4.5 years. And you see the bilateral nasal polyp score at baseline was 5.4. where most patients had an NPS or a bilateral NPS or five or six. The SNOT-22 score was 52, and most patients were anosmic. Actually, 120 of the 131 patients were anosmic. There was a mean Lund-Mackay score of 19, and the mean peak nasal inspiratory flow of 94, which is quite high. If you imagine that we consider 100 normal, but many of these patients, of course, had been operated a number of times, and some of them, for example, had extensive sinus surgery, so creating a lot of space for the polyps higher up in the ethmoid than the frontal. Patients had a type 2 characteristic. The blood eosinophils were 0.6 mean, the total IgE 280, And we scored of all patients whether they fulfilled the EPOS 2020 criteria. 127 patients had sign of type 2 inflammation in the blood. A few patients either had systemic steroids shortly before, but you can consider all patients to be to have type 2 inflammation. 88 patients, or 67%, had a need for systemic corticosteroids in the last year or contraindication for steroids. 73% had significant impairment of quality of life. As you saw in the former slide, more than 90% had anosmia, and 84% of the patient had a diagnosis of comorbid asthma. So if we look at how many of the EPOS criteria the patients fulfilled, you can see that 129 out of the 131 patients fulfilled more than three or more of the EPOS criteria and just were eligible for biological therapy if we take EPOS 2020 criteria as the standard. 45, so 34% of the patients had aspirin intolerance. And as I said, 130 out of 131 had a type 2 medical history, including asthma or aspirin intolerance. If we use the EPOS 2020 control categorization, almost all patients had uncontrolled disease. So here I show you the data of the 131 patients and what happened to them in the last year and a half. And of course, we have 12-week data of all the patients, but one who stopped the treatment because he had a pericarditis that was probably not related to the treatment, but we're not sure. And then the numbers go down to 98 having 24 weeks, 54 having 36 weeks of data, and 26 having 48 weeks. So the group is not totally comparable over time, but you can see a clear reduction of the mean total nasal polyp score going from 5.5 back to under 1. So it's an enormous reduction in the nasal polyp score, and that's what we see in daily life. In most patients, polyps are gone and they go fast. Even if we see patients after 4 weeks, as you can see in this left part of the slide, the polyps score went back to 3. So for example, 1 on one side and 2 on the other side. And then after 12 weeks, it's almost 2. So 1 on both sides, very little polyps left. Of course, a nasal polyp score is moderately interesting. We are much more interested in how the patients do. And in the middle figure, you see the SNOT 22, where you see that patients went back from over 50 to around 25 at 4 weeks. So a 50% reduction in their SNOT score, and then further down a little bit to under 20. And as you know, 20 is the score of the normal population. So you can see that, you can say that in about 3 to 6 months, patients' SNOT score totally normalized. If we look at the sniffing sticks, you can see that patients improved from a score of 3, which as I showed was anosmia, to a score of a little bit over 8. So they still are, some have excellent smell, but not all. So the mean score is still hyposmia. But enormous improvement in scoring and quality of life of the patients. 4 patients had to cease the treatment. In 2 patients, the CRS was not controlled as much as we wanted. 1 patient had persistent hypereosinophilia that we couldn't control. And as I said, 1 patient had a pericarditis that we think was already there before he started the Dupi treatment, but we're not absolutely sure, and for that reason stopped the treatment. The patient was very sad because they had an excellent response. After showing you this general data, I want to share with you 1 example patient to show how fast the response of patient is. We ask all patients to fill in the Galenus app from Aphoria. And with that app, every day we score their general sinus symptoms, but also individual symptoms like facial pain, impaired smell, nasal blockage, runny nose, post-nasal drip, bloody secretions on a daily basis with a visual analog scale. And here you see the general sinus symptoms. So this patient scored 9.5, 95, depending whether you talk of millimeters or centimeters, on his sinus symptoms. And he started the treatment on January the 5th, 2020. And you see what happened in 1 week. So on January the 12th, he scored a visual analog score of 1.5. So from 3. So from 9.5 back to 3. And if we look 1 week later, his sinus symptoms almost totally disappeared. These were the general symptoms. But if we then look at impaired smell, of course, a very important symptom for patients that they're not able to smell, not able to taste their food. Well, here you can see what happened to the smell. It looks almost like the same graph. Within a week, patient was able to smell. And we see that in about half of our patients, that there is a very fast recover of the smell. In some other patients, it takes longer. And of course, there is a group of patients where the smell is already destructed by the disease. And in those patients, the anosmia will not recover. But this is a nice example of patient coming in after a month saying, well, after a few days, I could smell again. And in the beginning, we couldn't believe it. But then we looked at this data from the app, and you can see that it's actually confirmed. Same true for nasal blockage, and it becomes boring. The same was found for runny nose, but post-nasal drip is the symptom that remains relatively high. So you see here the score of post-nasal drip, and it is significantly reduced, but not as nice as all the other symptoms. So here you see the total score of these symptoms, all the graphs put together. You can see that this, apart from post-nasal drip, all main symptoms of chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps are vastly reduced. In a few weeks, most of the symptoms are gone. And so many of our patients, and I don't want to make this a biological advertisement, but I'm really very enthusiastic about it. Many of the patients say they got their life back in a period of weeks. There is at this moment 1 study published on real life experience in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps in the Annals of Allergy and Asthma Immunology, giving the same sort of data, but in a much smaller group of 29 patients. You see that the male preponderance was less obvious, but the age very similar to our series. Here they recorded all the comorbidities. 90% of the patients had allergic rhinitis, also just like our group, 80% had asthma. 7% atopic dermatitis, and also 24% had NERD, NSAID intolerance, or what we formerly called Sempster's triad. Also, their group, 96% of the patient had anosmia. Everybody complained of nasal congestion. And you see here the previous treatment of the patients. Everybody was on nasal steroids. Most patients had nasal irrigation. And 45% had oral steroids. In this group, half the patients were operated. Here you see on the left figure the response to treatment, and you see the same sort of data. 80% of the patient had a complete response versus 10% having a partial response, and only, well, 3%, so that's one patient who had no response. On the right part of the right figure, you see the persistent anosmia, persistent agasia, persistent oral steroid use, all one patient or one or two patients, persistent nasal congestion a little bit more, but the real nice data, more than 80% of the patients, no polyps anymore, and more than 90%, almost all patients, a decrease in polyp size. So very comparable data to our group, and also making us just as enthusiastic. This paper also reported side effects. Two patients had side effects, and what resulted in discontinuation of the therapy of one patient. The two patients in the cohort did not experience significant improvement with DUP. One patient discontinued following an adverse reaction of a diffuse rash. We haven't seen that at all, but it may happen. And one patient maintained DUP because the asthma improved significantly, but not the polyps. They also reported, and we have the same experience, that conjunctivitis, which is reported in the literature, especially in patients with atopic dermatitis, is not or hardly seen in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps that are treated with dupilumab. So to summarize, we now have the possibility to prescribe biologics in real world in patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. The data at the moment are still limited, but I'm sure they will very fastly come into the literature in the next months and years. At this moment, there are two real world studies, one published, and our series is under editorial consideration at the moment. Both show an enormous reduction in nasal polyp score, and fantastic improvement of smell, and a fantastic improvement in health-related quality of life to the level of normal patients. In both studies, dupilumab was very well tolerated. And we now have data of dupilumab, and we also have a small series of patients with omalizumab, but of course not yet of MAPO, which is not yet approved in the EU. But I assume also those data will become available in the coming years. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you're now totally up to date, both on the pathophysiology, the study data, and the real world data on biologics, and the fantastic opportunity it will give us in the coming years to treat our patients with chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. And we're very happy to answer your questions.